All right, let's stand and worship together.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're a living hope. Your presence, Lord. Tasted and seen of the sweetest of love, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Tasted and seen.
You here. We desire to experience your presence among us this morning as we worship together. Amen. You can be seated.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome. So good to see everyone today. I guess you're the few that are not traveling, so you're here today with us, and we're glad to see you. A couple of exciting things to let you know about as we're heading into fall. A lot of fun things coming up for the kids and a lot of church community family type stuff that we're going to be doing, and so I want you to get it on your calendar so you can make sure you prioritize that and set some time aside so we can be together. First of all, I don't know if anyone noticed the new offering boxes in the back. I know Jill did because she used it this morning. So I am particularly appreciative of that because I am no longer carrying the 1960s wooden box up the stairs and down every Sunday and locking it into place. So just so in case you're wondering where that went, you could just so easily miss them because they're just so slimline and just sitting nestled right in there. There are two on either side on your way back out into the narthex, so just so you know where those can be found. Secondly, our trunk sale is coming up quickly on September 18th, and so if you are going to be out and about walking in the beautiful weather that we have been having, I encourage you to grab a couple friends, grab some of the door hangers on your way out. We did some on this past Thursday night, and got most of the people on Amity, but if you could share them in your neighborhood, just stick them on the door. You don't have to talk to anyone. It doesn't have to be scary, right? It's okay. That would be really helpful to us to go ahead and do that so we can involve as much of our community as possible in this exciting event. And then finally, because they didn't have enough camping, Jeff is taking our senior high students camping on September 11th and 12th, which is next weekend. If you have not signed up your senior high student that's 9th through 12th grade, you're going to want to do that. It doesn't cost anything, but just let us know that they're going to be coming. We can share the details with you, and we can make sure they have enough food so they don't start turning on each other. So we always want to feed them when they're camping. That's a good thing to do. Our other kids will be moving up in their classes on the 19th, and then on the 26th, our student nights kick off. We're really excited about that. To have our new middle schoolers joining us and our high school students. We're going to be together for some time of play, and then we're going to separate for some time of study. So all a bunch of exciting things happening. If you have questions about any of those things, you can reach out to me this week. You can reach out to Jeff or even ask Sarah in the office, and she'll have all those details for you as well. For now, let's stand and continue to worship.
Worship time, and that we may focus on you. We just pray for the message to be received, God. We thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated.
Well, good morning and happy Labor Day. Labor Day has a storied history of unions and manufacturing and the quintessential working class American. But here's a fun fact maybe you didn't know. In the world of meatpacking and food retail, Labor Day is the marker point for the end of hot dog season. The National Hot Dog and Sausage Council, yes, there is such a thing, it's a real thing, the National Hot Dog and Sausage Council says that annually between Memorial Day and Labor Day, Americans eat 7 billion hot dogs. Can we pause this morning in fervent prayer for the collective digestive systems of our country? My word. Well, speaking of hot dogs, last week we paused our regularly scheduled programming, so to speak, and those among us who enjoy sleeping on the ground and waking up with a sweaty rash went camping at Laurel Hill State Park. That was last weekend, and yes, we ate hot dogs. So if anyone here sits on the board of the National Hot Dog and Sausage Council, we did our part this year, okay? It was a great time. Weather held up, minimal rain, lots of laughs and good food, and we shared a simple worship service together last Sunday morning under a canopy of trees. But there was a reason, a purpose to all that. We've been in this message series called Off to the Races, been spending some time in the New Testament book of Hebrews, where we see this illustration of running a race as a metaphor of living Jesus' way, following after him, and having the strength to persevere in this faith journey together. Hebrews 12:1 has kind of been our central verse where it says, "Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us." We know, we know that race marked out for us, there in that verse, what the writer of Hebrews is referring to is laid out a chapter earlier in Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Or another way we've been saying it in this series is faith is confidence that God is who he says he is and that he will do everything he's promised to do. That's where we've been parked for the last several weeks. Now, in the first few weeks together in this series, we spent plenty of time looking at all the parallels between the challenges of running a physical race and the many different kinds of challenges of this race marked out for us, a spiritual race we've been talking about, living a life embracing the kind of faith that God has in store for us. But the one singular similarity we continually come back to is the demands of this race as a metaphor for our faith journey. They're both grueling and demanding. They at times can bring us to the end of ourselves, to a place where our energy and our resources feel depleted, which means both of them, the physical and the spiritual, if they get hard enough, can cause us to become exhausted, feel beat down, frustrated, sometimes even wounded and in pain and just wanting to quit altogether. It's a similarity in both the physical race and the spiritual race we're talking about. But that's the book of Hebrews. It was written to some very exhausted and frustrated runners. We've said that. First century Christians who had experienced intense persecution and difficulty that had them questioning everything and ready to throw in the towel. And those words can offer us clarity and encouragement as we seek to run our race, to have the strength to embrace a way of living that leans on God and his promises, not just on our circumstances and what our eyes can see and our brains can understand at any given moment, because those things fall short for us. We saw the next dimension of running this race when we continued in the next few verses in Hebrews 12 that say, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men that you will not grow weary and lose heart." See, we get running, and then we fix our eyes on Jesus. That's how we run. That's why we run. Jesus, who we just sang about, Jesus is the one who got us started on this race and the one who sees us through it. After all, he already endured the cross and was victorious over death and sin 3 days later. He's got what it takes to see us through. And then we came to another section in Hebrews that blew it all open. It's what things like the camping trip I mentioned that we took last weekend were all about. It's the repeated inclusion and emphasis on one word, us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Let us throw off everything that hinders. Let us run this race marked out for us. And Hebrews 10 goes on to talk a whole lot about how much this race isn't just about me and Jesus sprinting to the finish line, how it's not a solo act at all. It's a together thing where we realize that a pivotal way that we can best run this race to persevere through all of the hardest challenges is to run it with others. We spent a lot of time on this section in Hebrews 10, starting in verse 19. "Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body, And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, all the more as you see the day approaching. Because of Jesus, we are encouraged when we are together. Solo sprints are not for endurance. We need one another to remind us, to push us onward, to help us when we're faint, to be pictures of hope in the road ahead, to warn us when we're off course, just as we are pictures of that same hope to those who are a few steps behind us. We need each other, spurring one another on in real and honest and raw community. And so we got to see a little glimpse of that this past Sunday, this past weekend camping. Because I'm just going to say, it's pretty hard to keep up all the image management when you're camping. There's a couple light giggles. I mean, really, if you've ever been camping before, you can't do the whole, like, I'm really polished and shiny and can put on my... Everybody sees everything. Instead of walking into a nice church sanctuary in fine clothes and looking your best, you come stumbling out of a tent in sweatpants with swollen eyes and matted hair and a bad hip and have to beeline it to the bathroom before you can really talk to anyone. It's pretty hard to get caught up in appearances when you're camping. It just is. There's something else I took note of last weekend. It's easy to kind of fly beneath the radar when it comes to Sunday morning attendance at church, right? In a building like this. Maybe you were out kind of late Saturday night. Maybe you're just feeling a little off or just got back from vacation and still need to unpack or getting ready to go on vacation and need to pack. Or little Janie has her dance recital right after service, so it's just easier to skip out for a week. No one's really going to notice. Well, when you're camping in a cul-de-sac, you're holding your church service in a little grove of trees right at the center of all the camping sites. You can look out over all the sites where the Knoxes and Buffalinis and the Cassios and Fata Beans and everybody's staying. And you can just step forward a few paces and yell, "Hey, James! Hey, Anthony! You guys coming? We're waiting on you to start." See, it makes it a little harder to kind of fly under the radar because you're all right there together. There's no incognito. But it reminds me of that quintessential picture of the early church in Acts 2. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. You see, this race is best run when we run it together. I can't say it with more emphasis than that or with more clarity than that. This race is run best when we run it together. It's so important. If you're not running this race with your life intertwined in the messes and honesty of others' lives, you are missing out on God's intention for what faith and church is supposed to look like. We were meant to run this race together, period. So we're going to keep putting things in front of us here at NHCC to make God-centered togetherness a priority. Katie mentioned our senior high students are doing a camp-out retreat up at Jeff's Cabin next weekend as part of their fall kickoff. So senior high students and families, make sure you register for that. You can do it on the events page of our website. Invite friends, because we always want to invite people along with us on this race. And then the student nights kick off on September 26th, because we're meant to seek Jesus together. But togetherness is also one of the reasons we've again planned to do our community trunk sale this fall, where we invite our nearby neighbors to register to sell yard sale items in our parking lot in that morning. They just kind of register, they get a parking space or two, and they set up their stuff and they sell. They keep the money. It's not a fundraising, nothing like that. It's just a connecting with our community, meeting one another. We have food trucks, we have info tables, we have people helping with parking, people whose job it is to just walk around and hand out waters and just meet our neighbors, get to know people, invite them to consider joining us that very next Sunday. And then, Sunday, October 3rd, we're going to be taking our regular Sunday morning here, and we're going to do another together thing. We're going to serve together. We are partnering with Lifeline Christian Mission that weekend for another Meal Pack Sunday. Many of you may remember we did this about 2 years ago. We'll be set up downstairs, maybe some more in the lobby, some other places, all spaced out appropriately, and teams are going to operate meal packing stations and pack these ship-ready meals for Lifeline's Honduras mission community, because their meal supply was depleted when they sent immediate relief supplies to earthquake-impacted communities in Haiti. So we're going to do this meal pack thing over three time slots, 9 and 10:30 a.m., kind of a little mini devotional and communion. We watch an instructional video, and then we go pack. But then we're also offering a 1 p.m. time where we want to invite our neighbors, our community, those families who have benefited from our meal distribution program, all of those. We want to encourage them to give back to help serve with us in this way as well. So they'll be invited into that 1 o'clock slot. Three different meal pack times. You're welcome to do as many as you want. You can do one, you can do two, you can do all three, but we need you to register so we can be set up and equipped properly. October 3rd, you can register for that online on our site. But see, all of these things are to remind us and to reinforce within our church body this importance of togetherness. And don't mistake me, when I say togetherness, we're not only talking about physically being in the same space, because you can be together without that happening. You can also physically be in the same space and not be together. We're talking about the spirit of togetherness, of true connection, true communities where relationships are intertwined. That's what we're aiming for with all these things. So all that brings us up to today. And to continue our running metaphor with this idea we've been talking about, of running with a faith that presses onward when life pushes back. Of running this race with perseverance, even when it feels like we don't have the stamina to go any further. The next thing I want to talk about comes down to one word. One word. And it's a word that makes most of us moan and roll our eyes and wrinkle our noses a little bit. But in our faith, in this race marked out for us, it's a non-negotiable. It's this word right here, nutrition. Nutrition. I want to share something ironic with you. I spent some time reading lists of foods that are the worst for you when it comes to good nutrition. And when I say worst, I don't just mean things that are high fat or have high calories or whatever. Not just that, but foods that physically, biologically have the biggest negative impact on your biology, have the biggest negative effect on how you live your life and how your body is supposed to work. Some of the things that are common to these lists you'd expect. Things like fried chicken and potato chips and that giant plate of fries with cheese, ranch dressing and bacon. I'm looking at you, North Park Lounge. But I want to share with you the three things that I found in the top 10 of several lists, and their irony is worth noting. Three things that make the top 10 for being absolutely awful for the overall health of your body. These are ironic. You ready for this? Diet sodas, margarine, and those flavored low-fat, interesting. Non-dairy creamers. Low-flavored may also be an accurate statement. But do you see the irony here? All three of those things that are supposed to exist as some kind of a healthier option, right? But those are the things that are actually worse for you than a big bowl of pasta Alfredo. Not because pasta Alfredo is a healthy choice necessarily, but because there are so many chemically destructive ingredients in those things that your body was never meant to consume. Your body can't pull nutrition from things with ingredients that were created in a petroleum factory, okay? So nutrition, that's our word. We hate that word because it carries a different connotation than just the word eating or food, right? Eating's a word I can get excited about. I love to eat food. I like to make food. I like to talk about food. I think Anthony Nicasio and I spent at least half the camping trip trading personal recipes and food tech prep techniques. But eating is an easy word to like. But the word nutrition makes us aware that what we are eating matters. Yet sometimes we fuel our bodies the way Doc fuels the futuristic DeLorean in Back to the Future, if you remember that scene. It needs fuel, so he pulls a brown banana peel and an old half-drank beer out of the trash and dumps it in. Sometimes I think that's how we fill our bodies, and maybe our spiritual minds as well. We're busier than ever, physically speaking, busier than ever, and in our quick transitions from work to appointment to activity, we grab a handful of Pringles and a chemically treated chocolate muffin from Sheets, wash it down with a Monster Energy drink, and then we wonder why our doctor tells us we need to pay more attention to our nutrition. You can only run on garbage for so long. And the same is absolutely true in this race we're talking about in this series. Food is fuel for positive movement. What you eat has a direct impact on how your body performs and responds. You need to eat the right proteins and consume the right kind of foods to maximize your body's performance. There's no shortage of resources for marathon runners that outline with painstaking accuracy what you should eat and how much you should eat and how often you should eat when it comes to preparing for running a marathon. It's serious business because what you eat has a direct impact on how you run. We've read about already how we need to throw off those things that trip us up and weigh us down, how we need to fix our eyes on Jesus, how we need to run together to encourage one another and spur one another on. But the burning question then becomes, where do we get the fuel to keep running this race? Where's the proper nutrition and dietary intake to keep us pressing on the way we need to? Jesus himself answered this question very plainly for us. He was quoting from the Old Testament when he said in Matthew 4:4, as Jesus answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Let me cut to it right here. If you really want to run this race that we've been talking about for the past several weeks, then you need to feed regularly on God's word. There's no other way around it. There's no quick grab-and-go substitute. But see, here's a problem. I just casually mentioned energy drinks. We live in a quick-fix energy drink kind of a culture. You notice this? Years ago, there was maybe just a few four-packs of energy drinks when you walk down the grocery store aisle. But now there's an entire aisle dedicated to the energy drinks, these sugary, hyper-caffeinated energy substitutes that trick your body into thinking you're actually being given energy-producing nutrients. Real fuel, real energy. But all they do is give you this quick fake surge and then you crash. And if you drink enough of them over the long term, your health will pay for it. Sometimes I worry, spiritually speaking, we are feeding on the wrong stuff. The spiritual equivalent of fast food and fried chicken and ho-hos and Diet Cokes and energy drinks. And then when our faith journey gets demanding, which of course it does, that's what all these other weeks we've talked about tell us in Hebrews, when it does get demanding, we crash because we haven't been fueled properly. We haven't paid attention to correct nutrition. We need the Word of God, the Bible, the life and words of Jesus himself. We need that to fuel us. Jesus tells us in that passage I read, it's his Word that sustains us. And let's just be honest with each other. The fuel of consuming God's word is not a fast food drive-through. It's more like a sit-down meal. It's a deliberate, purposeful thing, not a quick fix to get you through. All those social media inspirational memes and the quick one-liners in between commercials on K-Love and daily self-help affirmations, they're never going to be the nutrition that you need. They just trick you into thinking that you're feeding yourself because they're quick and accessible and they go down easy. Ah, the affirming word of the day from Caleb. Now I feel like I've been fed on God's word. That's not how it happens. So if you're running on empty in this race, maybe it's time to take a look at your eating habits, spiritually speaking. Because if you're going to run in this race for the long haul, if you're going to have the strength and the endurance to persevere through the challenges, you need the proper nutrition. We rally around a phrase here at NHCC that helps us bring clarity and focus to our biblical mission laid out in the scriptures. It's connect, grow, serve. You've heard this before. How we connect with God through His Word, connect with others authentically, and connect with those who have yet to encounter Jesus. That's the connect word. But one of the things when we look at the word grow is for us to become increasingly independent in feeding ourselves. See, nutrition is a core structure of who we are as a church. It's the importance of you, of me, each and every one of us that are running this race, each and every one of us who call ourselves followers of Jesus, learning how to fuel ourselves, how to take the responsibility to feed ourselves and get a healthy diet from God's Word. So this morning, if you have your Bible or Bible app on your phone, or even just grab one of the pew Bibles or follow along on screen, I want us to look at some words of instruction and encouragement from the Apostle Paul to a young church planner named Timothy. Paul writes in 2 Timothy chapter 3, "Continue in what you have learned and become convinced of, because you know those from whom you have learned it, and how from infancy you've known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through Christ Jesus." The first thing you see in that passage is the word continue. It's a Greek word that literally means to stay on the course you've been on without deviating. Sound a little bit like the word unswervingly that we looked at a few weeks ago, keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus, running straight ahead. Continue, undeviating. Paul tells Timothy to continue in what you have become convinced of, the verse says. Continue in your faith, just like we've talked about, that confidence that God is who He says He is and will do everything He's promised He would do. That's the Hebrews 11 verse. Remember, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance of what we don't see. That's what Paul is encouraging Timothy to stay on the course with, to continue in, knowing that he has a foundation of being taught the Scriptures from a young age, from faithful women in his life. His grandmother Lois, his mom Eunice, they were mentioned earlier in Paul's letter. We know that. But then Paul says, all those Scriptures that you've learned and become convinced of, that you're continuing in that, they are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. He says, Timothy, everything you have learned from Scripture has been pointing to the truth and revelation of salvation through Jesus Christ. Press towards Him with His strength, His truth. Paul's saying, Timothy, it's been about Jesus the whole time. A steady diet of feeding on God's Word brings us into a greater knowledge of Jesus and our relationship with Him. It's been about Jesus all along. Paul, this isn't the only place that Paul says this. It's like Paul writes in Colossians 1, 15 through 17 when he says, "Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together." Or the way the Gospel of John opens, where it says in John 1, 1 through 4, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." That's Jesus. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. Paul says that's what it's been about from the beginning. He says to Timothy, all these Scriptures you've learned and become convinced of are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Paul's reminding Timothy, he's reminding us today, that if you want to know Him, if you want to follow Him, then you have to feed yourself, sustain yourself with Him, His teaching, His life, His Word. Jesus, the Word of God in the flesh, the One who all the Scriptures have been pointing to all along. All that is to say, I'm going to make a very bold statement here this morning. It's this: how well you know Jesus is directly connected to how much you feed on God's Word. How well you know Jesus is directly connected to how much you feed on God's Word. Because God's Word gives us the full picture of the character, the truth, the grace, the justice of God Himself and of Jesus. And you simply can't know and accurately understand the person of Jesus apart from the truth of God's Word. You can't. if you're going to follow Jesus, if you're going to run in the race that he has set out for us, that he has put in place, it's pretty important you're following after him, your eyes fixed on him, and not some surrogate Jesus of your liking. We don't get to make up our own custom Jesus. People do it all the time, of course. There's people who follow a Jesus of generic love and tolerance and feel-good theology. Or some really like the social justice Jesus who seems to exist only to fly the flag of any and every cultural cause du jour. Dave talked a little bit about those kind of things last week. And then there's the Jesus of health and wealth, who comes to save us from the persecution of financial trouble, unimpressive houses and cars, wrinkled skin and yellowing teeth. A lot of people really like that Jesus. Or you have the Jesus of legalism and judgment. Some people follow that Jesus. And of course, there's the ever popular confirmation bias Jesus. This is the Jesus who simply exists as an imaginary authority you can point to, who always supports all of your personal views about everything from church practice to politics to finance to personal hygiene. That Jesus has a lot of followers. There's a lot of people following something they call Jesus, but it's not the Jesus of the Bible. How well you know Jesus is directly connected to how much you feed on God's word. That's what fuels us to live, to run this race marked out for us. And Paul continues to his letter to Timothy by saying more about this nutrition program, starting in verse 16. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Four great words and phrases there: teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness. Those are the English translations in the NIV from the original Greek. I just want to take our few final minutes to mention each one because they're all very much a part of this nutrition program for running this race together. Teaching, it's the first one. This is just a Greek word that refers to conveying factual information, sharing the truth, receiving instruction. Pretty straightforward. God's word is useful for pointing to and discovering truth. But look at this. Just a few sentences later, Paul says this to Timothy. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound teaching. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. Sounds like the world we live in to me. There's no shortage of sources that will reinforce whatever it is you want to believe. We have become a culture of people who no longer know how to deal with others not agreeing with our perspective on anything. We simply surround ourselves with the echo chambers of sources that support and reinforce what we already believe. And truth then becomes something you define based on your own views and preferences and ideologies. Everyone has their own truth defined on by their own separate echo chamber of sources and voices telling them what they want to hear. How else do you explain Christians through history convinced that the Bible supports everything from slavery to a flat earth to abortion to polygamy to ethnic cleansing? We are starved for the truth and the foundation of God's word. So feeding on God's word is useful for teaching. The next word on the list is rebuking. Rebuking. This is the word that varies the most between all the English translations. Some use the word rebuke, some use the word reproof, some use convince, some use convict. The original Greek is a word that has two parallel meanings. The more literal meaning is this idea of some standard that you test other things according to. Something that you test something against in order to detect mistakes. The other more abstract meaning is when you are internally, you are convicted about your errors. You can see how these are really the same meaning, right? God's word is useful for convicting us, for allowing us to see our mistakes, our errors, our sin. It is the truth, the standard by which we measure ourselves against. This begins to show us something. This list that Paul writes to Timothy, it's not randomly ordered. It's a process that can take place as we feed on God's word. God's word teaches. It points to the truth, which in turn convicts. It demonstrates to us our errors, our sin against its truth, which in turn leads to the next word in Paul's list, correcting. Correcting. We don't like this word much, just like nutrition. We don't like nutrition. We definitely don't like correcting. Did you wake up this morning, and as you're getting ready for church, did you say to your spouse, man, I sure hope Ethan talks about that 2 Timothy passage because I could really go for being corrected this morning. Anyone say that? Anyone ever say that? Now, my kids have this down to an art form, the art of correcting others, especially mom and dad, and generally anyone who lives under our roof. Anyone ever have one of those instances where someone is verifiably wrong about something, but they are emphatically convinced they are right and everyone else is wrong? And the more anyone tries to show them, to correct them with facts, the truth, it makes them that much more convinced that everybody's out to get them and they are right? Ever witnessed the absurd intensity of exchanges like that? They happen in my house every day. No, but I know that every single one of us, we've seen those. We've been a part of that. Maybe we've been that person emphatically convinced we are right, and there's nothing you can tell me to say that I'm wrong. The Greek word, though, that's translated as correcting isn't really a negative term. It's just a word that means a course correction. Something being adjusted back to straight again. I'm sure Daryl Bolin would have something to say about the word, the world of chiropractic care here, but that's what this word is. It's shifting to get back on course, to get back to running straight ahead with our eyes fixed on Jesus. So there's that application of unswerving again, right? That's what God's word does, and we get to help keep each other on track in this race, spur one another on. God's word teaches, it points to truth, which in turn convicts us of our sin, which in turn prompts us to course correct and get back to running straight again. Let's put up the text once more for the last part of this list. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. Now, words like rebuking and correcting, those are reactive. They're words where you're responding to something that happened. But training in righteousness, that's a proactive phrase. It's something you do for the sake of what has yet to happen. If you don't train, you have no hope for the marathon, no matter how good your intentions are, no matter how strong your willpower or how hard you try. Not going to work. God's word is useful for training in righteousness. Training to be more like Jesus, the one who the truth of the scriptures has been about all along. When you feed on God's word more and more, it shapes how you think, who you are becoming, how you make decisions, how you establish priorities. It becomes the filter through which you make sense of the world and interact with others. Training in righteousness is how the Bible shapes us to do life God's way. That's how Paul kind of wants to land this whole thing in his letter to Timothy. All the teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training is so that we can run this race our very best. Look at verse 17. We do all those things so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That's the end game. So what are you eating? There's your question. What are you eating? What's your nutrition plan? What is feeding and fueling and sustaining you in this race? What are you eating? I want to encourage everyone here, everyone listening, to feed regularly and purposely on God's word for all the uses Paul writes to Timothy about as we run this race together. If you've never really made a habit of reading your Bible, maybe you're not sure where to start with Jesus, one of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. They tell the life of Jesus. Maybe you've had a good nutrition going plan going for a while, but you got off track. You know you need to get back into making it a habit. Take some steps and invest in this race and increasingly learn to feed yourself. One or two Sundays a month listening to the pastor talk isn't going to sustain you, I promise. Pick up God's word and read it. Feed on it. Get to where you crave it. There's a Bible study that Debbie's starting at the end of this month called Eat This Book. It's the idea of just making the reading and feeding on God's Word something that can come alive in your life and your priorities, making a habit of spending time in God's Word. That's Tuesday nights coming up in a few weeks. And Karen Landis is leading a women's book study starting this week on Wednesday morning, looking at Jesus' interactions with women in the first century to provide a richer picture of who he is and how to draw closer to him in worship and intimacy. Plug into one of those studies. Get plugged into our life groups that we'll be starting back up here in several weeks. Message the office if you need more info about those, because what you eat matters. But the bottom line is open God's Word for yourself. You have to. See, your ability to run this race marked out for you, to carry out what Jesus wants you to do, is directly connected to the amount of time you spend ingesting what Jesus has to say in his Word. Jesus' half-brother James put this angle on it when he wrote in James 1, "Do not merely listen to the Word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the Word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he's heard but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does." Hear it and do it. Continue to do that. Be a doer, not just a hearer, not just a reader. Run and don't just talk about running. Remember, the Bible is food. It's not just an end in itself. It's fuel, fuel to help you run after Jesus. It's the best nutrition plan to help us run the race marked out for us. We're going to close this morning by symbolically participating in that together through ceremony, by taking communion. When we take communion, we remember the saving work of Jesus on the cross for all of those who put their trust in him. And I want to read from John chapter 6. "Then Jesus declared, 'I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty.'" He goes on to say, "Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me." I want to walk through that together this morning, just like Jesus did with his disciples at the Last Supper. So I'm going to ask you to hold the packet you picked up on your way in this morning. There's extras in the pews if you didn't get one. If you put your trust in Jesus, I invite you to participate with us. So hold that in your hand. Paul writes about this occasion in 1 Corinthians 11, where he says, "The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Go ahead and peel back the top layer to get a piece of bread. Hold the bread in your hand. As you're holding the bread in your hand, I want to say this. Jesus says in John 6:51, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Let's go ahead and eat that bread together right now. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Peel back the other layer, and let's take the cup, the juice, together this morning. Let's do that. Continue to be in a posture of meditation and of worship as we reflect and sing together this morning.
The mountain I could not climb. desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of
has lost its grip on me. You have
Jesus as our living hope. The song embodies what we talked about this morning. And if you're joining us this morning and you've not yet entered this race that we've been talking about, haven't yet made that commitment to make Jesus your living hope, please catch me after service. I'm just going to be standing right up here. Message me if you're joining us online. I'd love to talk to you about that step, about finding new life, what it means to be baptized, to invite you to discover this Jesus, the strength and the hope and the forgiveness that he brings, the new way of living, new way of thinking and running this race. Or maybe you sang those words about Jesus being your living hope. You know it in head knowledge, but the rest of you struggling to keep up with the race you're trying to run. Remember to keep running with others and to take stock of your nutrition plan, of what you're eating, your diet, because it matters. I'm happy to talk with anyone in that place this morning if you want to find me after service as well. I encourage all of you to get involved here with those together things we've put in place. Things coming up like the trunk sale, the meal pack Sunday, study groups or small groups, or any number of ways to serve and get involved. Let your lives intermesh so we spur one another on here at NHCC. If you have questions, talk to anyone of us on staff. I'm so glad that you came to join us this morning. Can we stand and close in prayer together? God, thank you for your love for us. Thank you for Jesus Christ, our living hope, who has won the victory. God, convict each and every heart, each and every mind here this morning of the importance of the nutrition plan, of getting into your word for themselves, not just a surrogate thing or a grab-and-go thing, but getting into your word. Help us encourage one another to take those steps, to be a church of your truth and your word and your conviction. Be with us as we go. Pray in Jesus' name, amen. Before you head out, make sure when you do, grab some trunk sale packets and hangers to distribute. Katie can be back there with questions. Thanks for being here this morning. Let's close in a final song of celebration together.